In part two, I spoke with Professor Meer about John Dube's legacy as a liberation pioneer.
Well, while I'm here, we should see if we can find some time to just chat, because of your perspective on the Dube story that probably nobody else has.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you know, the perspective you come from, the, you know, academic background, the political, you know, background, and also, I mean, the community, you know, background that you come from, give you a unique insight into the whole Dube story. So my wish today is that we talk about that, and because that will also reflect or tell us something about who you are and where you come from and what role you played in this,
yes,
in this long, long, long process.
Yes.
I mean, you see, because it's been so long that the pieces are so many. So you are an important piece. That's basically what I would like us to talk about. So you are free, really, to every now and then I may ask questions.
But, yeah, sure.
But let's start from that that angle, you know, and then chat. Although we know that we don't want to exhaust you too much, you need your rest. But you tell us whenever you know you need to stop.
Yeah, no, stop. You go ahead. Don't worry about
okay,
me.
Okay, very good. Okay,
I'm fine.
Okay, you are fine. Okay, very good. All right.
I have given so many long interviews. So that I don't want to be parsimonious with you, you know.
Okay. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I mean, this is a blessing. You are really making us a gift here.
Yes,
this is
no,
a
it's
gift
a pleasure
for me, for a lot of people, for a lot of people. So thank you so much for it. Yeah. So should I just begin? Okay. So Professor Meer, it's a great pleasure to be here at your house in Durban to chat with you about your perspective and recollections of the Dube, John Dube's role in developing this community, the role that his legacy is playing today in South Africa. So I wanted us to chat a little bit about that, because I know you have a privilege in a connection with the Dube family, namely with the late Angelina Dube.
Mm-hmm.
So I want us to chat a little bit about that. So yeah, it's yours.
Well, John Dube is the founder of the African National Congress, and that is an aspect of his life which has not been dealt with in your film.
That's right. That's right.
But that is a very important aspect of John Dube's life. John Dube was in the unique position. He was both modern and traditional. He had the confidence of the local chiefs, and they played a very important part in the colonial history of South Africa, because the British were after them, wanted to get the land from them by letters, you know. The colonialists were, for them, as for the European man, even today, everything is contract. If they don't conquer, then they go along and they make very clever contracts which suits their purpose. So if they cannot get your land through war, they will then get it through contract. And the chiefs, whatever their rights, will sign these letters for small rewards. And the people know absolutely nothing about what is going on. But John Dube was a modern African, and he wanted independence for his people. He wanted dignity for his people. But at the same time, he wanted to preserve the traditions of his people. So although he was himself a Christian, He respected Christianity and took all that was good from it. But he never forgot that he came from an African tradition, and there was a great richness about that tradition. And it was a moral tradition and a very human tradition. And he discovered that it was, in fact, in many respects, a more ethical tradition than the Christian that he had contacted with. He knew Christianity to be the value and the belief system of the European and the American world. And he knew that that world was very sharp, and that that world was on the threshold of swallowing the other worlds, the other countries, the other traditions. So he stood up to this challenge in the last century. He wanted the coexistence of the modern and the traditional, because he realized that in the traditional there were values that the Christian civilizations could never appropriate or approach. The Christian industrial capitalist society that wanted to swallow, colonize, and swallow the rest of the world, they were very selfish. They had no concept of sharing whatsoever. In fact, they couldn't share because they were out to take over the countries for themselves and their peoples and their resources. So sharing was out. And whatever Christianity said about sharing, they killed it. Now Dube saw that in his own African tradition and religion, sharing was number one, right at the top of the agenda. You shared. You did not selfishly appropriate. And you certainly did not exploit.
The neighbor.
Yes, he saw how even colonialism prospered because of the indigenous African tradition of sharing. They didn't throw out the colonizer when he came in with all his implements and ideas to possess, to conquer, to dominate and destroy. So he saw that coming along. He had the vision. He was a very far-sighted, a very intelligent man, and equipped. He could understand two cultures, the traditional and the industrial, that was overtaking the world. He understood both. And he saw the goodness and the value of the traditional. And when he saw the goodness and the values of the traditional, he saw that the Christian was no patch on what was already his. So Dube was not going to lose what was his.
Right.
Now he succeeded in establishing the African National Congress because of his respect and appreciation of the traditional. And the overlords of the traditional in Africa were the chiefs,
right,
the Nkosis, the kings. The people respected them, and it was the Nkosis who united the people and gave the people an African value system, African authority, African politics, African government. Do you see?
That's right, exactly.
So he respected the chiefs. Respecting tradition meant respecting the Nkosis.
Exactly,
so the Nkosis had a respect for him. So he founded the African National Congress, firstly, by uniting the Nkosis.
Okay, I see.
So it wasn't to start off with a modern organization.
No, definitely, yes. You had to start at the top, because in African traditions,
yes,
when you go, you send a village chief, if you convince him, then you
then you
the
get
the people,
people. That's right.
Okay.
So that's the way Dube went. And that's the way Luthuli went as well. Luthuli followed Dube in that. Luthuli lived in Groutville,
yeah,
which is always also in that same area.
And from what I understand, I mean, you know, Luthuli attended very briefly Otlange, but went and finished at some other school. But he probably was the person that Dube educated the most, in the sense that Dube was his mentor. Dube really trained him for decades before, you know, he could rise to prominence and
yes,
to literally take his place.
Mm.
When he moved out of the scene, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So he and Luthuli were really followers of the same approach.